Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Triangulation, episode 160, recorded July 21st, 2014. Mary Jo Foley. It's time for Triangulation, the show where we interview some of the most interesting, smartest, most provocative people on the internet. And I love doing this show. It's so much fun because I get to meet so many people. But every once in a while on the show, we like to take people that I already know, that you already know, and get to know them better. And this is one of those shows. And actually, as I think about it, I know very little about our guest, even though for at least a couple of years now, she's been co-hosting Windows Weekly with Paul Theroux. Ladies and gentlemen, Mary Jo Foley. It's nice to see you, Mary Jo.
Thanks, Leo. Outside, nice to be on.
Outside the Windows Weekly context.
Mm-hmm.
How long has it been that you've been on Windows Weekly? It seems like more than 2 years, maybe.
Yeah, I think it's close to three.
Three? Wow.
Yeah, I know.
You were a regular guest, and when mm-hmm. Paul was gone, would fill in, and of course, we quoted you all the time and still quote you all the time because you're really the queen of Microsoft News to this day. Did you start, I know nothing about you.
Okay.
I know you live in New York. I know you like beer. I know your apartment is mm-hmm. small, that you have no TV, no Xbox. That's all I know. I know more about your computer habits. I know you have an Acer S7 laptop. I know about the shopping and all of that. But I don't know anything about your history. Where did you go to college?
I went to college at Simmons, which is an all-women's college in Boston.
And did you study journalism?
I did study journalism.
You knew that's what you wanted to do?
Graduated in 1983.
Mm-hmm. And you knew that that's what you wanted to do?
I knew. This is one of those crazy things. I knew since I was about five that I wanted to be some kind of a writer.
Why? How did that happen?
I don't know. Like, you know, when people ask kids, what do you want to be when you grow up? I would tell people, I want to be a newspaper reporter.
Really?
My mom's like, wow, where'd that come from?
I never heard a kid say that once. Astronaut, yep. Cowboy, pilot, nurse, but doctor, but never newspaper reporter. Was there a TV show? Did you watch Superman and want to be Lois Lane?
Yep. I like that show a lot. And I really liked writing, even as a kid. And one of my earliest presents I can remember, I think I was probably like 10, my parents gave me a plastic typewriter.
Oh, you see.
That actually worked.
That's formative.
And I used to type little, like, newspapers for our home and distribute them.
Oh, you really? You grew up in Boston area? Where'd you grow up?
Yeah, I grew up in Ashland, which is a small town about 30 minutes outside of Boston.
You have no Boston accent.
I've totally lost my accent. Except if I've had too many beers, it comes out.
Really?
Yeah.
Really? Like, because Paul's like that a little bit. Paul Theroux, your co-host. He every once in a while, a little Southie will come out of him.
Exactly.
And it's like, whoa, that was wicked hot. So was it strong?
Yeah. And my mom still to this day has the true Kennedy accent.
Oh, she's got the Brahmin accent.
She does. She does. She says all those things like "park your car," and she makes fun of how we all talk.
It's so funny. I grew up, as you know, in Providence, and the Providence/Cranston accent is a very nasal version of the same. It's funny. New England's not big.
I know.
We're from Boston, but it's a distinctive accent.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
even it within is. Boston, there are distinctive accents.
There are. Yep.
Did you consciously lose it? Did you, like, practice? Were you at Simmons and said, I can't talk like that anymore?
My college roommate was from New Mexico, and she used to make fun of my accent.
Oh.
But I think it was mostly because I watched a lot of TV. And, you know, when you watch a lot of TV, you start talking like people on TV. And
right.
Most of those people don't have accents.
We all have mid-Atlantic accents, actually. Mm-hmm. We do have accents. Obviously, everybody mm-hmm. has an accent. But it's the standard American accent is kind
it
of...
It is.
Sort of a mid-Atlantic, I guess.
Yeah.
Maybe in more, thanks to Tom Brokaw, more of a Nebraska accent. So you trained it out of yourself. Were you the editor of the high school newspaper, all of that? What were you like in high
yep.
school? Were you a nerd in high school? Mm-hmm.
Oh, I was a big nerd. Big, big nerd. But not a tech nerd at all.
A drama nerd, a band nerd, an English nerd?
No, like an English nerd. Like I... I loved taking English classes and extra writing classes and reading extra books just because I loved reading. I was a big nerd.
Were you socially active or did you kind of hide in the corner?
I was somewhat socially active, but kind of more just kept to myself and just blended in.
See, before the show, I told Mary Jo, is there any areas you don't want to go? And you probably didn't think that I'd start talking about your high school social life. But I like to get, you know what? It's so funny. There's no opportunity to get to know people in the shows we do. You know, we'll get there. We're doing Windows Weekly. We're going to talk about Microsoft. We're going to talk about Windows.
Yep.
And, you know, over a period of 8 years, I've kind of gotten to know a little bit about Paul, but it's always in little dribs and drabs. Same with you. And so I have no idea. You know, the only reason we know what Paul looked like is in high school is because he's putting pictures on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
And he was quite the looker.
He was. Head. Those dimples.
Ooh.
Yep.
Have you been posting pictures for Throwback Thursday on Facebook? No.
No.
Are you even on Facebook? Do you even do that stuff?
I'm on Facebook. I do as little Facebooking as possible. I just feel like it's kind of an invasion of privacy.
I agree. And that's one thing I seem to feel about you is that you're a very private person. Is that what
I am?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's another reason we know so little about you. A lot of people, you know, people know way more about me than they care to. Because it's all blah. But you're fairly circumspect. You don't talk much about your personal life as we talk about Windows. So you majored in, was it English or journalism in college?
Majored in communications, so more in the journalism bent of things.
So even then you thought newspaper?
Yeah, I was thinking newspaper. I wasn't sure what I would cover because in those days, if you went to school for journalism, you didn't really specialize typically.
Right.
So I just was a generalist and I'm like, I wonder what I'm going to end up covering when I graduate. Who knows?
Yeah, because usually when you go to work for a newspaper, they give you the crappiest beats to start with, the crime beat or the city hall beat or something that nobody else wants to do. And then you kind of work your way up and the highest, you know, eventually general assignment reporter, then feature writer. Mm-hmm. Maybe if you're really good columnist. Is that kind of what you saw your career path as going?
Yeah. I was thinking it would go that way, but instead it went a very different way.
What happened?
Actually. So when I was in college, one of my side jobs was I was a Kelly girl. You know?
Which, oh, yeah. I remember
you
that.
You know what that is?
Yeah, temp girls. Yeah.
Yeah. I was
Kelly
a temp
girl. That's, even in the 80s, they still call them Kelly girls?
They did. Whoa. So I used to go to make money, go into different offices and type because I was a pretty fast typist. And one of the places they sent me was a tech magazine that was just starting up called Electronic Business. And my job, this was like in 1982, they sent me in there to enter the reporter's stories on a Wang word processor.
Oh, wow.
So they would give me their yellow pads with their stories.
They
and
were
I would
handwritten?
Type yeah.
Holy cow.
A lot of times they were.
And you would have to type them in.
Yep.
And unlike most people who would say, this is the most boring material I have ever had to type in, you said, wow, this is kind of interesting. Mary Jo has a cold, and I apologize.
So I do, I'm
I appreciate
sorry.
You're doing this with your cold.
Yeah, no, not a problem. So I was kind of interested in what they were writing about, but it was mostly a lot of stories about things like components, you know, resistors, capacitors.
Yeah.
So I hadn't taken science in forever. So I just had always thought, oh, science, so boring. There were no computer classes when I was in high school, so I had never been exposed to any of that. And one day, one of the editors there said to me, don't you go to journalism school? I said, yeah, I do. And he said, do you think you can write? I said, I think I can. So he assigned me a story, and the very first story he assigned me was to write about beryllium copper wire. Can't make this up, right?
How horrible is that?
I know. Yeah.
And you wrote it.
And I did it. And he edited the heck out of it. And finally it got published with my byline. And I remember my dad was so proud.
Oh, yeah.
He brought the magazine into his office and he's like, look what my daughter did.
Oh.
And everyone's like, wow, what is beryllium copper wire? And he's like, I have no idea. I don't think she does either.
But yeah. did you try to write like a strong lead that would
get...
Did you really?
I did.
Do you remember what the lead was?
No, but it was something about the supply of it being limited and how it was impacting mini computer vendors.
Yeah, that's a good lead.
Yeah.
And you want to read and find out what happened. What did your dad do?
My dad was an accountant.
Okay. Did your mom work or did she stay at home?
She worked. She was the alumni director for Framingham State College.
Oh, neat.
Yep.
And did you have, I don't even know if you had siblings. Do you have a brother or sisters? Yeah.
Yep. I'm the oldest of four.
Big family.
Yep. You know, Irish Catholic. Three
small
girls
family in that case.
Yeah, true.
Small family.
True. Yep.
Usually we have 10, 11 kids in the...
Yeah, on our street, we were one of the smaller families growing up.
The Kennedys, they all had massive broods.
Yep.
So did your dad identify with the Kennedys?
Not so much, really. I mean, both my mom and dad were from Massachusetts, and they had stuck pretty close to home. So they just kind of accepted them as part of the scene.
By the way, the chat room has immediately found the Wikipedia article on beryllium copper wire. So if anybody's interested in becoming
an expert, you want to know.
Beryllium copper wire. But that's good. So you got some positive reinforcement. You got probably a tiny check because magazines like that don't pay very well.
Nope. But when I graduated from college, they made me an offer. I got two job offers when I graduated, them, electronic business, and Condé Nast Travel and Leisure.
Wait a minute. And you chose beryllium wire over Tahiti?
You know why? This is even dumber.
What?
Because it paid $1,000 more a year.
Well, no, that's not dumb, actually.
I mean, but it was $1,000, right?
It's not a huge amount, but...
No.
You know, travel writing's a grind and probably does not pay as well, frankly, as business writing in the long run. So I think you actually, clearly now you made the right choice.
Yeah, I totally feel like I made the right choice, but it was a very random choice at the time.
Yeah.
I told them when I interviewed with them, I know nothing about technology. And they said, we'll train you. We'll let you learn on the job. And we think you can do it.
You know, it's always a debate, and we have this debate here, and certainly have always had this debate, whether it is better to get somebody who can write and teach them about technology, or better to get somebody who loves technology and teach them how to write.
Mm-hmm.
And you believe in the former school.
I believe in both schools.
Yeah. It's different. It produces different results. But I think people often think, oh, John C. Dvorak must have been a geek. No. He was a wine writer, a food writer.
Oh, he was? Wow. I didn't know that.
And somehow got into the computer thing. And many of the best computer press folks were not geeks, but were writers first. So I don't think that that's very unusual at all.
Yeah. I mean, you just have to really be willing to immerse yourself in what you're learning about and really want to get into it. If you don't like what you're covering, you're probably not going to be very good at it.
Well, that's the problem. I mean, there are a lot of people, and I might even put myself in this group, who faced with writing an article about beryllium copper wire would just say, this is too dull even for me.
Mm-hmm.
But you thought this is something you could do. Was it a challenge? Maybe that was the challenge.
Mm-hmm. It was a definite challenge. And the good part, too, was it was a very flexible workplace. I remember after I wrote about components for a few months, I went into my editor and said, you know what? I actually want to write about something else. And he said, what would that be? And I said, software. I don't even know how I came up with that.
Wow. But in the 80s, actually, that was a smart move. That was a very smart move because everybody was covering hardware. You look at Computer Shopper, which was this thick in the 80s. It was all about hardware. But software was soon to take over. Hardware but now is meaningless.
Yep. So they said, sure, what do you want to write about as your first story? So I just was kind of making it up as I was going along. So I went down to the Boston Public Library and did some research in the stacks because we didn't have the internet then. And I looked up a couple things and I came back and I said, you know what? There's this company called Microsoft. And I think they're going to be big. I think I should write something about them.
And this was in 83, 84?
Yep.
Wow. That's pretty good. I mean, they'd already done, they were doing DOS, MS-DOS.
They were. Yep.
Windows had not come out yet or was about, was imminent, but not had not
right
come
around
out.
Then. Yep.
I mean, it wasn't a huge stretch to think that Microsoft was going to be, it was an important company. It was, but it certainly wasn't dominant at that time. Lotus was dominant.
They were. Yep. And all the mini computer companies are big then. Right. You know, that was one of my first things. DEC, Data General, Prime, all the companies that are gone. Wang.
Up Route 128 right there.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. In the Massachusetts area. How fast did you type?
I probably typed about 90 words a minute.
Whoa.
Not that fast, but.
Well, that's That's more than a word a second. Yeah. That's pretty fast.
Yeah. In high school, I took typing in shorthand because I, again, was thinking I was going to be a reporter, and I thought that would be useful to know.
Have you watched Halt and Catch? Oh, you don't have a TV. So there's a new TV show, which is not very good, about the exactly that era, 1983, mm-hmm. and the computer era and the first PC clones.
Oh, really? Wow.
Yeah. Hmm. I'd be very curious to see what you think of it.
Mm.
Do you not? You don't
What's
watch,
the name of it?
It's called Halt and Catch Fire.
Huh.
And as a technology reporter from that era, you might remember there were halt instructions on CPUs, mm-hmm. and there was mm-hmm. a joke among programmers that there was a HCF, a halt and catch fire, literally catch on fire.
Wow.
Instruction, which obviously wasn't. Well, interesting. So you didn't have you have the novel in the drawer though, don't you?
Nope.
I
definitely do not.
No hankering to write fiction at all.
I love reading fiction. In fact, I only read fiction pretty much. I don't read any business books or tech books as a rule. But I don't think I'd be very good at writing fiction. I've never tried.
What are you reading right now?
You're going to laugh when I tell you what I'm reading. This summer, I'm going back and reading classics I have never read before.
That's awesome.
So I just finished The Great Gatsby, which I had never read before.
Is that not an amazing novel?
I loved it so much. And now I'm reading Slaughterhouse-Five, light.
Another great novel.
I know. Yeah.
When you read The Great Gatsby, you kind of understand, oh, I get why this is such a famous novel. You can read Middlemarch and go, I don't understand why we're reading this. But you read The Great Gatsby, you go, this is really kind of amazing. Especially
and it's so short,
and it's
right?
easy. It's very accessible.
Yeah. Yeah. It was really good.
There's one sentence. I actually copied it down. I reread it when the Baz Luhrmann movie came out, because I was thinking, wait a minute. Is that in... I reread it, and I was kind of stunned that the Baz Luhrmann Great Gatsby, the one with Leonardo DiCaprio, is actually almost page for page directly from the book.
Oh, wow. Is it really?
Huh. It's more true to the book than the previous Great Gatsby. There have been a few other Great Gatsby movies. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of surprised, frankly. I thought, this can't be... I mean, there was no rap music in The Great Gatsby, and of course, Slaughterhouse-Five, what a great book. You must have read Other Vonnegut.
I have never read Other Vonnegut, nope.
Oh, a whole world awaits you of joy and fun.
I see
So
that.
You read more modern fiction, then?
I do, yeah.
Do you have a favorite author?
I don't really. I just try to read very widely.
Yeah.
A lot of literary fiction, which I really like.
You know what I love that I'm reading right now that won the Pulitzer this year? Have you read any Donna Tartt, T-A-R-T-T?
I have.
She's great.
I read The Goldfinch. Yeah.
Oh, isn't The Goldfinch great?
It was really amazing.
I'm reading it right now. And her Secret History, which was the first novel of
hers
was I
great
read.
Too.
Isn't that great? Takes place kind of up there, and that probably could have been Simmons.
Yep, could have been.
Well, that's interesting. So that's your recreation, is going home with a
it
good
is.
Book. And do you read it in a book form or in a Kindle?
Kindle. Yep.
When did you start doing that?
Oh, man. I got the original Kindle, and now I'm on the Paperwhite. So probably like 4 or 5 years ago, maybe.
Yeah. And you prefer that now?
I do. Because I don't have a lot of room to save books here. So it's just handy to have them on the Kindle.
Now we're getting a very interesting Skype artifact. All of a sudden you have a nose tattoo. I don't. Would you rub? Oh, look, it's all gone now. But now it's moved to your forehead. I'm sorry. Yeah, that
what's
fixes it. When you
that?
Put your hand there, it fixes it. I don't know what's going on.
Oh, when we were using this camera, when we were in Washington, D.C., we changed a lot of the settings on this thing.
And it's all, well, it's better now.
Is it? Okay.
But you're very good. You rub those tattoos right off.
And excellent.
When you watch this video later, you're going to go, oh, I know what he, I see what he was doing. That was weird. So you went right into the your beat was technology from day one out of college.
It was. Yep.
And do you regret that deeply, profoundly?
I almost got out of the field in right around 2000, 2001, because I was thinking, I don't think I got in the right field, and I'm not sure I made the right choice. And when you have that kind of moment of doubt.
We've all done that.
Yeah.
I did that too. When I was about 32. I said, this is crazy. What am I doing? Yeah.
Yeah. I enrolled in chef school.
What? So you love to cook?
I love to cook.
Ah, we found something now. Like something I can bite into.
Yeah. Yep. So I was still working. I had moved back to New York. I moved a lot for my job. I lived in Seattle and I lived in California. I lived all over the place. When I moved to New York, one of the first things I did was enroll in a vegetarian cooking school here.
How interesting.
And I was going nights and weekends to get my chef's degree.
Oh, that's neat. And did you?
I did.
So you are a accredited vegetarian chef.
I am.
Did you ever?
But I don't use it.
Well, you know what? If you'd ever worked in the industry, you'd know why you'd.
I know, right?
Writing is so much easier than cooking for a living.
Yeah. Oh, and the money. You know, if you live in New York City, I don't know how people make ends meet. You know, getting $7 to cut carrots.
Yeah.
Per hour.
Which school did you go to? The CIA? Did you go to Johnson and Wales? Or what did you?
No, I went to one that's called the Natural Gourmet, which is specifically a vegetarian cooking school.
So you were a vegetarian back then. You've been a vegetarian your whole life. When did you start being?
No, I've been a vegetarian about 20 to 22 years, somewhere around there.
Huh. How did that happen?
I don't know how that happened.
Was it about animals? Was it about health? Was it?
I'm not really sure why I started not eating meat, but once I started, I'm like, you know what? I feel healthier.
I feel better.
Yeah. So I haven't since. I eat fish still, so I'm a pescatarian.
Pescatarian. Okay. Yeah. Being a vegetarian chef would be a great specialty. You probably could command a top dollar.
But I know. Well, when I finished school, one of my classmates who I went to the cooking school with, she had just started a private cooking business.
Oh, neat.
And she had some pretty big name clients in New York. And she really, really put the hard sell on me to switch and to dump tech and go work with her. And I didn't.
Regrets?
No. No regrets now. At the time, I was like, I'm probably going to regret this. But I actually don't regret it because every day still, I wake up and I'm like, you know what? I still like my job.
That's good.
That's really lucky.
Well, I like this beat too. I chose this beat. Mm-hmm. I like it because it's different every day. There's always a story. There's always something. Now you really focused early on Microsoft since 83 or 84.
Yeah. 84 is the first time I interviewed Bill Gates. That was when I did my first interview with him.
Do you feel like Bill knew you pretty well and you had this respect for you?
No. No respect.
He didn't like you?
He knew me pretty well.
He knew you, but he didn't like you.
No.
You've said this before, that there have been times when you've been persona non grata at the Microsoft campus.
It's true. It's happened.
Why is that?
Sometimes
fair.
I don't know.
Well, you get scoops.
Yeah. You have different rapports with different teams at the company, and some teams are more open to you doing your job and trying to find out what they're doing. They're like, hey, you're a reporter. That's your job. Other teams, not so much.
They see you as a spy.
They don't think you should do it. When I lived in Seattle, they thought I was a spy. I moved to Seattle to cover Microsoft in the early 80s.
Uh-huh.
Early 90s. Uh-huh. And everybody who found out I had moved there, they said they hired you to be a spy, and nobody wanted to be my friend who worked at Microsoft.
Wow. Were you still working for Electronic Business or that? No, because
I was working for PC Week, back then.
So you left Electronic Business to go to PC Week?
excuse me. I went to a Unix magazine in between that time. I know.
You didn't cover Microsoft for the Unix magazine, did you?
No, I covered Sun Microsystems.
Oh.
And I wrote all about Unix. About Sun specifically, but about the Unix market in general. And that's when PC Week hired me because they needed a Unix reporter. And they said, hey, here's somebody who actually knows about Unix. Let's hire her.
Somebody in the chat room who shall remain nameless says, I was extremely impressed with Mary Jo Foley's coverage during my 6 years at Microsoft.
Okay.
She was consistently able to get real, multi-sourced stories. She also had the self-control not to run with the single-source stories, even when we knew that they were true.
Yeah.
That's high praise.
It is high praise. And, you know, it's such a dying art how we used to have to source things. When I worked for PC Week, John Dodge was my editor, who you probably knew.
Oh, yeah.
And they had very stringent standards. You had to show that you had three independent sources on a story. not three people who told each other, three absolutely independent sources.
Yes.
And that's the only time you were allowed to run something.
Wow, that is a standard that is long gone.
Long gone.
Even eWeek probably doesn't adhere to that anymore, the successor to PC Week. Interesting. And you, but it sounds like you embraced that, that you understood the reason for that and, and embraced it.
I did. I did because, you know, it's fun to be first. It's not fun to be wrong.
Yeah. Do you remember
and if you're consistently wrong, people stop reading you because they say, you know what, she never has anything that's right.
I think of a lot of, I can think right now, you know, because it's, the blog is, once it went online, the race to become first became so much more important that, that's really now all that matters. And I can think of tipsters and bloggers who we just don't trust anymore because they've got it wrong. And it maybe even are more right than wrong. But if you get it wrong a few times, that really sticks in the memory. Did you ever get any big stories wrong?
I'm sure I did. I'm trying to think of one I might have gotten wrong. There's ones I went out there on a limb a couple times and I was scared because in one case I'm thinking of, I had only one source, but I knew the source was solid. But then this thing runs through your mind and you're like, what if they're setting me up?
Right.
What if what if they're trying to make me look wrong?
Right.
Yeah, so I
can remember even on Windows Weekly, there have been times I can see your hesitation where you know something's true, but you're just hesitant to get it wrong.
I know, because it does so much damage if you go out on something that's going to affect a lot of people's livelihoods, just purchasing.
Well, that's not merely damage to your reputation, but it's damaging to the world, to the country.
It really is.
Yeah.
Yep. I mean, we're not covering, world politics and big things like that here, but it's still, you can get people fired.
Sure.
You can have people, lose their jobs because you told them wrong information. They can buy stuff that you told them was a solid product that a company was backing, and then they drop it. You want to be right.
Any of your sources ever lost their jobs or gotten in big trouble because of you?
Yes.
How do you feel about that?
Not good. Yeah. Yeah, it has happened a couple times.
Why do people leak?
That's such a great topic. We could do a whole show on that sometime. There's so many reasons people leak stuff to us. And sometimes they're mad. They lose their job at a company and they say, I'm going to get back at them. I'm going to give Mary Jo Foley their product roadmap.
Right. It's revenge.
Sometimes, yeah, sometimes it's revenge. Sometimes it's just their product is on the chopping block and they say, if you write about this, maybe they won't kill it because it'll be all out in the public and everybody will want it. I even had somebody once feeding me information because this person was spurned by somebody at a company. They were trying to date them. Yes. And they wouldn't date them. So they decided the way to get to them was to give me all the information about what they were doing.
Wow.
Yeah, it's crazy why people leak stuff. Some people want their names associated with stuff. Sometimes they just want to say to their friends, I gave her that.
Yeah, even if it's anonymous, sometimes it's still for the glory, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah.
Yep.
Even if it's just you, even if you're the only one who knows, it's a little bit of glory. So you have to, did you become an investigative reporter very early on? It seems like you have a knack for this.
Yeah, I always kind of wanted to find out the scoopy stuff, you know?
That's the fun thing to write about. Much more interesting than beryllium, copper, wire.
Definitely.
There's no scoop there. That's just news. No. That's right. Man bites dog. You wanted to find out why the man bit the dog.
I did. And once you get a taste for that, it really is kind of intoxicating. Yeah. When you see your scoops go up on places.
You still get them all the time.
I know. One I remember, though, that I just still remember this one. And even some people use this as part of their email signature at one point. I wrote a story about Microsoft leaving 64,000 bugs in Windows NT when they shipped
it. Yeah.
They put a memo out, but the memo was meant to kind of spur the team. Like, all right, look, we didn't close 64,000 bugs in this, but we're going to ship it and we're going to fix it. And so I ran it and I explained that, but everybody started picking it up. And I was on a plane going, I think like to San Diego or somewhere. And I get out in the airport and I look up at the TV monitor and there's a thing that says 64,000 bugs left in Windows NT. It was on CNN and I was like, oh boy, I'm going to get in huge trouble for this one.
Were you at PC Week at the time?
Yep.
Wow.
And I did get in big trouble.
From whom? From Microsoft?
Yeah, I got kind of blacklisted for a while by the Windows Server team for writing that.
Was that your first case of getting blacklisted?
I think it was. May have been.
Dvorak tells a story, I don't know, apocryphal or not, of walking through the halls at Microsoft and peeking in, I want to say Steve Ballmer's office, but I'm not sure, but somebody like Steve Ballmer's. And no, maybe it was, might have been Pam Edstrom. And seeing enemies list on the blackboard, names of journalists that under no circumstances should you give any information to.
Yeah.
Do you think that that was real, that there is such a thing?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
I definitely think that was real. We all had, at one point in Microsoft's history, they were keeping tabs on all the reporters, and you had a profile. And they accidentally emailed my profile to another journalist one time, and he gave it to me.
Whoops.
And it was just kind of a list of, yeah, since she wrote this, we're going to do this to her. Or since she said this, now we're going to make sure she never gets this person. And it was kind of eye-opening. You're like, oh, okay, that's how this works. I get it.
I guess I understand if I put myself in the company's shoes. But at the same time, I feel like it's not merely dumping on Mary Jo Foley. It's dumping on your readers. It's dumping on their customers.
Yeah.
Because aren't you ultimately representing the customer in your quest to get this information?
I like to think that's why I'm doing it, you know, and that I'm trying to be their advocate.
Exactly. You know?
But sometimes you can question your motives. You know, you think about yourself and you're like, yeah, am I really doing it for that? Or am I really doing it because I want to like nail this person who's been really a jerk, you know?
Hey, it can be both.
It can be both.
It can be both. Yep. I think you have to be a little bit of a psychologist, don't you? Do you cajole people into giving you scoops? How do you? Okay, now nobody from Microsoft watch this. So, do you actually intentionally kind of groom people in this way?
You know what? I try to be pretty upfront and not trick anybody into giving me stuff, you know? I'll say like, hey, I'm trying to get a story on this. I've heard this. I've heard that. What do you think? Should I go with this? What do you know? And if they say, I won't tell you, I'm like, okay, then you won't tell me. I don't try to browbeat them.
You don't.
I just say, you know what? I'll find out from somebody else. And I just kind of leave it at that.
You have your dignity.
I think they do, right? And you don't want to like trick somebody into giving you something and then they are all like stunned when they see it run. You don't want that.
As always, this is nothing new, but I'm so impressed by your integrity and the quality of your journalism reflects that. Was the 64,000 bugs your biggest scoop? What was your biggest scoop?
That was definitely one of them. And the funny ending of that story was the person whose email it was sent me a note and said, by the way, I don't know how you got into my email box, but that was my email. And you spelled my first name wrong.
Could you fix that, please?
Yep.
If you're going to quote me, fix it.
Yeah.
One of your biggest scoops happened on Windows Weekly. You actually affected Microsoft's stock price. Paul Theriot was patting you on the back for that.
Oh, yeah.
And you didn't want to take credit for it.
Yeah. You know, some of them you're like, yeah, other people had it too, or everybody could have gotten that story. I guess the ones I'm more proud of are things where you kind of put two and two together and you're like, oh, everybody kind of just missed this. It was out in plain view and nobody saw it. You know?
So it is a little bit of psychology, but it's a little detective work as well. Mm-hmm. I can see why you love what you're doing. Have you ever thought of doing some other company? I guess Microsoft, there's still today, it's even more interesting than it used to be.
I know. Just a couple of years ago, I was thinking, you know what? Maybe I should switch beats because what else is there to say about Microsoft? They're kind of in a rut.
Yeah.
I know. And then suddenly, we have a new CEO and, you know, everything's different. And I'm like, oh, they're still interesting. I'm going to stick with them.
You must have. No, I agree. In fact, there was a period. We were doing Windows Weekly. And, of course, when we started doing Windows Weekly, Vista was just about to come out. There was a lot to talk about. And there really was this lull where Microsoft was just in stasis. And it was still doing, you know, Windows Phone 6.5. And, you know, it was just boring, and there wasn't much to say. And then, but Steve Ballmer kept us kind of a little interested. You interview Bill Gates how many times?
Maybe like 5 times, over the years.
I've always resisted, and I've actually passed, I passed up once the chance to interview Bill Gates. This was during Comdex because Microsoft wanted us to give them the questions before we talked with Bill.
Yeah.
What do you do when they say that?
I give them some questions, but I'm like, yeah, I'm going to hold some back.
Yeah. And when you spring an unprepared question on them, do they take umbrage and bristle and throw you out?
Sometimes. Yeah, sometimes. You save those for the end. So when they're going to storm out or lock themselves in the bathroom and not talk to you, you can say, okay, I got most of what I wanted.
Has anybody ever locked themselves in the bathroom?
Yes.
What? Who?
Bill Gates.
What?
That's actually a really funny story.
Wait, yeah, tell me. Because of you?
So I was doing an interview of him at Comdex with a couple other journalists.
Right.
John Dodge was there, too.
They ferry you in groups, yeah.
Yeah, we all were working together for PC Week. And John's interviewing style is very different from mine. He is an awesome journalist and one of the best bosses I've ever had. But he's really like somebody who eggs people on and tries to get them to say stuff. And so he was really needling Gates and needling him.
Do you remember what
Gates
it was about?
It was about something stupid, like a definition of a market or something. Gates was getting madder and madder. I was kind of watching. I'm like, what's going to happen now? And he just like got up, went in the bathroom and locked the door and wouldn't come out. And so Pam Edstrom had to go to the door and say, Bill, come on. Come on. And he's like, I'm not coming out until John apologizes. So John went to the door and said, Bill, I'm sorry. And then he came out.
Oh,
and
my God. This is the richest, the richest man in the world.
Yeah.
One of the most powerful men in the world. He locked himself in the bathroom. I'm not coming out till you apologize.
Exactly. But you know what? There was a different Bill Gates back then, right? Like Bill Gates changed a lot over the years. And I always say to people, he became much more human. You know,
yes.
Once he had kids.
You think
Melinda
and the kids did that, didn't they?
He really changed.
Yeah.
He used to be very kind of like typical, like volatile.
Nerdy kind of
tech personality.
Yeah,
yeah. And then he became human. And so when I tell people these stories about him in the old days, they're like, Bill Gates, really?
There's so many great stories about Bill Gates. Somebody was telling me about getting in the elevator with Bill and his mom. And his mom would take off Bill's glasses and clean them and put them back on. Because Bill's in his 30s, but he was he didn't care about personal hygiene. He didn't care about any of that stuff.
Nope.
And his glasses would be filthy, and Mom would say, come on, Bill, we got to clean your glasses.
That's a good one. My daughter, I have a stepdaughter, and she and I, when we were living in Seattle, were walking down the street one night, and he was walking towards us by himself, no bodyguard. And I said to my stepdaughter, that's Bill Gates. She's like, no, it's not. I'm like, it is. And he was all disheveled and like he had on a poncho and he looked all like, grr.
He didn't have to worry about anybody. Nobody would have thought him to be Bill Gates.
We walked past us and my stepdaughter said to me, I thought that was a homeless person.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah.
Wow. I can remember at Comdex, the Spencer the Cat party. Remember that? You probably went to quite a few of those. He was the pseudonymous gossip columnist for PC Magazine, and they would have a big party at Comdex everybody wanted to go to. And a guy dressed up as a cat would show up at this party, not really the reporter. I think there were a variety of reporters who were Spencer the Cat.
Yes, there were.
Over the years. And Bill Gates would always come. Everybody would go to this party, including Bill Gates. And I remember dancing next to Bill Gates.
Me too. Yep.
Like this.
Yep.
With his butt out. I mean, he really did the white man's overbite.
He did.
But even then, I did not want to go up to him because I felt like I'm never going to get a straight answer from a CEO. I don't like interviewing CEOs because there's, you know, Pam Edstrom, who was the publicist and they later spun off Wagner Edstrom, which was the Microsoft PR firm for many years, really made sure that Bill did not say anything of import, right?
Right. Right. I mean, but he was his own person, too. He would blurt stuff out occasionally.
That's what you hope for, right?
Yeah. If he was mad about a story, he a couple times when I was at a conference, he'd just start bellowing, Foley, get over here. I want to talk to you about that story you wrote yesterday, you know?
Was that intimidating at all?
A little intimidating, but I remember one time I walked away from him when he was yelling for me, and another reporter said, Bill wants to talk to you. I'm like, I don't want to talk to him. And I just walked off.
Now, we've talked, you got the exclusive interview with Steve Ballmer, his kind of final interview, his exit interview. And you had a pretty good relationship with Ballmer, right? You interviewed him many times as well.
Yeah, a few times. Although I didn't get to interview him for the last 18 years. He was Microsoft.
Yeah. Were you embargoed?
I don't know what happened there. It was funny because he would see me at conferences and he would come up and shake my hand and chat with me. But the PR interviews. Team just would not let him talk to me.
Would they physically pull him away?
Yeah, pretty much.
He strikes me as the kind of guy, he's a glad hander, backslapper that would have talked to you had they right?
I think so. Yeah, he was really good. And I actually was a big fan of his. So I was really glad they gave me the last interview with him when he was still the CEO.
It was a little odd. That last interview. Tell us about the shoes.
Yeah, the shoes were weird, right? He has this thing, Ballmer does, that he remembers people by their shoes, which I didn't know at the time. He looks at your shoes, and that's kind of how he remembers names, I guess. And I didn't know that till I was interviewing Satya Nadella, who wasn't yet the CEO, but he was talking to me about Ballmer. And he said, did he look at your shoes? And I said, yeah. And he said that, yeah, if you see him 20 years from now, he'll remember what you had on.
Wow. That's a salesman's trick, I guess.
It is, I guess, right? Yeah.
It's a little strange, but yeah, it's a mnemonic, right? It's how they can kind of remember you and remember the details of you. That was something very different between Gates and Ballmer. Gates was, I would guess, not knowing him, a very brilliant businessman, but he was first and foremost a technology guy, right?
Right.
He loved technology. He took great pride in the fact that basic program was coded so well. I mean, he never got over that even. Talked about it a lot. Mm-hmm. And Ballmer's a sales guy. He's not even really a technology guy.
And he admitted that. He admitted that throughout his whole CEO-ship. He just would say, I'm not the tech guy. I'm the sales guy. And I know quite a bit about tech, but I'm the sales guy.
Yeah. Big difference. Different styles of running. Who was your favorite interview there?
Oh, man. People ask me that a lot, and I've interviewed so many people there. It's kind of hard to pick one.
Do you like talking to people like Sanofsky?
Yeah, not so much. Yeah. I didn't get to talk to him.
He's kind of volatile, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, he was a tough guy for me. I know some people actually did interview him and thought he was really a good force inside Microsoft. That wasn't my experience.
Yeah.
I liked interviewing I got to have a series I did where I interviewed the distinguished engineers and tech fellows at Microsoft.
Those people are really great. Yeah.
And they're all like these amazing, famous award winners, right? And it's very intimidating being somebody like me who has no tech background, being told, hey, go interview this guy who just won like the Turing Award, right? Okay. Yeah.
But I did,
and it was awesome. Yeah.
I find that when you talk to people who are really brilliant, that they're really diverse. I mean, Nathan Myhrvold is a good example.
Yeah.
I mean, a chef. Talk about chefs. He's written cookbooks.
Yeah.
But also a brilliant technologist and a huge number of patents to his name. And did you ever interview Nathan?
I did. Yep. Interviewed him when he was still at Microsoft.
What's your sense of him? Because he puzzles me because, of course, as some of you know, he's now become the world's biggest patent troll.
I know. Yeah.
And I had all this respect for the guy for what he has done, but he seems to be doing some real negative stuff now.
Yeah. I don't know. He did some really amazing stuff at Microsoft. He was very involved in some of their early, what was called Tiger, I think, which was going to be their TV stuff. So he was always kind of like the crazy scientist, right?
And brilliant guy.
Yeah, really brilliant guy, really interesting guy. I don't know what happened after that.
Yeah. Well, you know, if you have a lot of patents, maybe you kind of err on the side of, well, patents are sacred and we should we should allow people to take advantage of our patents.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if that's kind of the way he looks at it.
Yeah. Alvy Ray, did you ever talk to him?
No.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Who did you... Come on, give me one person you really enjoy. It doesn't have to be your favorite. I hate that. It's the worst interview question ever.
I know.
Best, favorite, number one. I hate those questions, so I apologize for asking that.
No. It's just kind of like an embarrassment of riches almost when I think of the people I've gotten to interview. I'll tell you the one person I haven't got to interview that I have the biggest regret not interviewing?
That's a good question. Who?
Dave Cutler, who's the father of Windows NT. Yes. And he and I have exchanged email before, but he would never talk to me in person. And I always wanted to interview him.
I agree. Now, what's he doing now? He's not at Microsoft.
He's still at Microsoft.
He is.
And he's still working on Xbox now.
Let's see if we can get David Cutler.
Oh, man, if you can, good luck. I've tried everything. He even signed a copy of Showstoppers, you know, which was the book about how Microsoft created Windows NT. He custom autographed a copy for me, and he gave it to somebody to give it to me because he wouldn't come and give it to me himself. Yeah.
G. Pascal Zachary's great.
That was a great book.
Zachary Pascal. Yeah. I always get his name mixed up. Anyway, great book, Showstoppers. Still highly recommended.
I still love that book. I was rereading that the other day too, like excerpts from there. It's pretty amazing book. But I've got an interview, you know, like Don Box, who's really famous at Microsoft, as one of the guys who developed. I'm drawing a blank on the standard he developed right now, but he also went to work at Xbox, and now he's worked back on Windows. He's working there now.
Yeah.
Anders Heilsberg, you know, the father of C++, I get to interview him. Yeah. Yeah, there's so many really awesome, amazing people who work there who just, you know, people don't always know their backstories, and you get to interview them and you look them up and you're like, yikes, wow.
Yeah, it's fascinating.
It is.
Yeah.
It is.
There are people, though, and I don't think, Cutler, it's not about you. I think there are people who just feel like there's nothing to be gained by giving an interview.
Yeah.
They're heads down. They want to do their thing, and they're not particularly interested in getting publicity.
Yeah, and you know, if you read Showstoppers, you know Cutler's kind of a loose cannon.
Right.
And they're afraid to give him to the press.
It may be not Dave. It may be Microsoft saying that you may not
be. Yeah, he just kind of goes off. Yeah.
Karsten, let's get Dave Cutler. Don't tell him we've got Mary Jo Foley. And we'll get Mary Jo in here and we'll do you can do that.
That would be the best. I want to get him before he retires because he's also the guy who wrote VMS for digital. I mean, he's really like one of the most famous programmers in the world.
Yeah. And he's got to be close to retirement. I mean, he's got to be in his 60s.
I would think.
Yeah.
I think he's just kind of doing whatever he wants to do at this point, and they're just happy if he keeps coming to work.
You bet. Are you kidding? Absolutely.
I know.
Yep. Just to sign some books.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep. So do you think you'll continue to cover Microsoft forever? I mean, you've got another 20, 30 years in you. I mean, can you imagine Microsoft in 30 years?
Yeah, I think they'll still be around. I don't know. You know, you think from time to time, am I going to keep doing this? How long can I keep doing it? Because reporting is, it's kind of a young person's game in a lot of ways.
Not
right?
True.
I mean,
not true.
I don't know. I feel like when you look at how our field has changed in terms of what counts as reporting and what counts as blogging now, and I don't know, sometimes I'm just like, man, I just don't have the kind of 24/7, you never can take time off, you have to be on all the time and have to run around and chase people down. Not sure if I'm in it for that long.
But we
haul.
Need you. We need people like you who maintain that high editorial standard so that these kids, these bloggers, just kind of see what's possible.
I know. And I do value the like experience that you bring when you're somebody like me who's done this for a long time.
Yes.
So, I mean, I've gotten to cover everything from the Department of Justice trial of Microsoft. You talk to some of these younger bloggers and they're like, they were on trial with the U.S. government? Yeah. They don't know.
That started, Tech TV launched in May 1998, and it was started like 3 months later. And for much of the six-year span of Tech TV, that was the story.
Yeah, I bet it was.
It went on and on and on.
And there was so much about our industry and about just what was going on in the back rooms that got exposed through that trial.
Yes.
That it was just really crazy.
Yeah, no kidding. Well, Mary Jo, if you ever want to cover a different beat or even this beat and you just got tired of writing, you just want to talk. See, it's easier as you get older. You can just talk. you always have a job here anytime.
Oh, that's
nice to hear. Anytime. Oh, my God. We'd hire you in a heartbeat.
It's tough, though. You know, you got to say tech reporting beer. It's.
We're going to get to beer. How many stories a day do you file on allaboutmicrosoft.com?
Oh, it depends. Like last week on the day they had the layoffs, I filed, I think, four or five that day.
people don't get it. How much you it's not an 8 hour, 8-9 to 5 day for you.
No.
You wake up and it, I mean, basically your entire day is devoted to this, I would imagine.
Yeah.
And then you go downstairs to rattle and hum, you have a few beers and go to bed.
Exactly. That's my day.
No wonder you don't have a TV. Who has time?
No one has time. If you live in New York, I don't know how you have a TV because there's so much going on right outside your door, you know?
Yeah. So when did you get into, when did you get into beer and when did you get into brewing beer?
So when I moved, I've lived in three different apartments since I've lived in New York. I moved to New York in 1999. And the third apartment, which is where I live now, is it's in Midtown. I'm near the Empire State Building. And I was looking around kind of like for what kind of restaurants and bars were around here. And I walked past Rattle and Hum when I first moved to this neighborhood. So that was like 6-7 years ago. And I just walked in because I'm like, oh, an Irish bar. It's cool. And they handed me the beer menu and it had 40 different draft beers on it. And up to that point, I was like a Blue Moon drinker pretty much. And
That's made by Coors.
I know. And they handed me the beer menu and I just said, I don't even know how to read this. I don't know what any of these beers are.
Oh, wow.
And it was great because they were really into people trying beers. And they said, you know what? If you come by, we'll start teaching you about craft beer. And so I came by a lot and they taught me a lot about beer.
That's how I got into craft. So this is a relatively new thing for you.
It is.
Yeah.
It is. Yeah. And then 3 years ago, my sister gave me a homebrew kit.
Oh, wow.
And she gave me this really cool small one from Brooklyn Brew Shop that lets you only brew a gallon at a time. Because I couldn't brew like 10 gallons. I don't have space for that.
Yeah.
No. And so I've been brewing beer since then and trying out a lot of different recipes, making different styles. It's been fun.
It's cooking.
It's to me, it's exactly like cooking.
Yeah. It's a lot like baking, actually.
It is.
You pour in wheat, you pour in hops, you pour in, and you ferment, and baking's a little faster, but it's the same. It's almost the same kind of thing. And then at the end, you see how that combination worked, and then you go, okay, next, make notes. Yep. Okay, next time I'm going to try this. Like put a little orange rind.
They even call them beer recipes, right?
Yeah.
That's why they call them recipes. Yep.
And you're doing a different, you were doing names from the alphabet. You're like going through the alphabet. Was that what it was?
Yeah, I was codenaming my beers because I'm like, you know what? Microsoft codenames things. Yeah. I should codename.
What letter are
and
you
so,
up
yeah,
to?
So yeah, I was going alphabetically and codenaming beers.
What letter are you up to?
I think I'm up to like K or L.
Oh, wow.
I can't brew here in the summer because it's too hot. And if you bottle beer and it's warm, sometimes the bottles can explode. I've had that happen a couple times. Yeah.
What fun.
And my apartment gets hot in the summer. So yeah, it suddenly you hear this like pop, pop. And then you look in and you're like, oh, my bottles are all exploding.
Do you still cook?
I do. I cook a lot for myself.
That's fun. It's just you?
Yep.
That's hard because
it is.
Cooking for one is not as much. I mean, it's
it's
no recipes for one.
I know. I freeze a lot of stuff, but I'm unusual among New Yorkers in that I don't eat out as much as a lot of people do here because I like to cook.
What's your favorite thing?
I make a lot of fish dishes. Mm-hmm. Lately, I've been making a lot of soft shell crabs.
I love soft shell crab.
Yeah, same.
You can get it in Manhattan, huh?
Yeah, you can.
Yeah, we can't get it here.
I know. Yeah, it's from the Mid-Atlantic.
Right, it's
much,
Baltimore.
Right,
so. Balmer. Maryland. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I love soft shell crab.
Me too. Yep.
Dang.
Yeah,
have to come
so I make a lot of that.
Have a beer and a soft shell crab. I'm set.
It's the best.
What's your favorite way to make it?
I like to either pan fry them or just fry them straight up and then put them on a salad or sometimes on a sandwich or even on a pasta, you know, and have like some shrimp and scallops in the pasta with it.
Chat room says, get Mary Jo to take us for a tour of the apartment. I'm not going to do that to you. But what is the painting over your right shoulder?
Oh, this is a really interesting painting, actually. This is, so at one point in my life, I got to live in Haiti. For a while. And this is a painting from Haiti. It's made out of little scraps of cloth that women sew together and turn it into a painting.
Wow.
And I framed it to remember my time in Haiti.
That's neat. Were you a student when you lived in Haiti?
No, I was between jobs, and a friend of mine had just gone down there, and I decided to go and visit. And then I ended up staying for 6 months because it was a really interesting, but very troubled place.
It was. When was that, in the 80s or the 90s?
Yeah, it was in the mid-80s, you know, when Baby Doc was still running the country.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, there weren't many Americans down there, I can tell you that.
No. Do you speak French?
I do. Not well. I got out of practice, but I did.
Yeah. Haitian French is, I would imagine, a little bit different.
Yeah. Creole's very different.
Creole, yeah. And is that a little Buddha behind you on the shelf there?
Mm-hmm, it is.
Is that just because you like it, or are you a Buddhist?
I studied Buddhism when I lived in Seattle. There are a lot of different Buddhist sects there, and I was really intrigued with Buddhism. I don't know if I'd ever call myself a Buddhist, but I really was interested in some of the things you can learn from that religion about concentration and through meditation. And I think it's helped me be very calm.
I agree. I have a real affinity for Buddhism.
Do you?
Yeah. I love it. When next time you come out here, we always bring you to the beer places. Next time you come out here, we'll bring you to Spirit Rock, which is a beautiful
place. I've been there.
Oh, you have?
I've done a retreat there when I lived in California. Yep.
Oh, you know about it. You didn't do the silence retreat.
I did. not the three-month one. I did some of the shorter ones, though.
I've always wanted to do that, but I don't think I could not talk.
Oh, man, it's tough. It's really tough, but it's so good for you to do.
I think it is.
It's really good.
It really makes you.
Yeah. It does, and it makes you really understand all the screwed up ways your mind works.
Right. The mind is almost the enemy. Rub your nose again. We got the tattoo back.
Oh, no, not
nose
again.
Nose and forehead. Yeah, look, it's all gone. Fixes it right up.
Now there's a weird.
Uh-oh. Now we see your third eye. You better cover that up quick. We don't want anybody to know. You know what? I want to know more about Mary Jo. Now that I've gotten to know you a little bit better, I am fascinated. I'm fascinated. It's so great to talk to you, Mary Jo Foley.
Oh, thanks, Leo.
Wonderful host of Windows Weekly. One of the best. You're a good compliment for Paul, because
I think we are. We're really good compliments.
You have different ways of covering the same subject, and I think it's a wonderful pairing. You're kind of the saison. He's the triple Bach. No, I don't know. But actually, he wouldn't want to be that, would he? It's really a great pleasure every Wednesday to come in here and get to talk with you two guys. And I'll be honest, I'm not a huge Windows fan, as I think people know. I gave up on Windows a long time ago. But you make it fun. You make it interesting. And you give us some really deep understanding of what's going on and what is clearly one of the most important companies in the world. So I thank you for the job you're doing there, but also for the job you're doing to keep journalism, keep good integrity in journalism, and keep that alive. Thank you for doing
that. Yeah, thanks. Sometimes you feel like that's a losing battle, but I think it's something worth kind of teaching some of the new kids who want to learn about it.
You know what? It cannot be a losing battle. It's a battle we have to win.
Yeah.
Because I don't want to live in a world where the internet is full of stuff and you just don't, well, maybe we already do, where you just don't know, is this true, is this not?
I know.
It's like April Fool's Day every day.
I know. It feels like that sometimes, doesn't it?
It's discouraging.
It's very discouraging.
And you see great journals like the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, it's kind of going down that road and you go, oh my God, what's happening?
I know.
So fight the good fight. We need you, Mary Jo Foley. Do not give up.
Okay.
Thank you so much for being here on Triangulation today. It's really a pleasure to talk to you.
Oh, thanks for having me. It was really nice.
And
thanks.
We'll see Mary Jo in 2 days, Wednesday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern, 1800 UTC for Windows Weekly. Bye-bye. Thank you, Mary Jo. Feel better.
Thank you. Thanks.
You sound fine, but drink some emergency.
Yep, that's what I'm drinking.
Yep, echinacea. I don't know what it is.
Yep.
Yeah, something. Do a little meditating. Take care, Mary Jo. We do Triangulation every Monday. It's kind of my first show of the week. I really look forward to it. 11 a.m. Pacific, 1800 UTC. That's, at, like I said, about 2 p.m. Eastern time. If you want to join us live, I appreciate it. It's always great to have the chat room here. The feedback I get, the questions, the suggestions, very valuable. But, of course, you don't have to watch any of our shows live. All of them are available after the fact on demand, audio and video. If you want to see Mary Jo rub a smut off her nose, you get the video at twit.tv/TRI or wherever you get your podcasts, Stitcher, the apps we have, Xbox Music, iTunes, and all of that. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Triangulation. Bye-bye.